Good evening. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Midweek Bible Study. We are thankful unto the Lord for another day, another opportunity to come and to worship him and to serve him and also to study his word. Amen. Amen. Listen, listen. Do us a favor real quickly. If you would invite someone to join you for Bible study tonight, all you have to do really is just share this page on your page. Just share this broadcast on your page. And you basically saying, listen, join us for Bible study on tonight. You don't want to miss it. It's going to be some insightful teachings. And I'm not just saying that because I'm doing the teaching, but I believe there's going to be some insightful teaching. So I invite you to enjoy, to invite your friends and your family, your loved ones, and say, hey, listen, join us for midweek Bible study real quickly. Just do that. And then also just say hello, amen, something in the chat section to let us know who's with us on tonight's and in tonight's lesson time. Just invite you and encourage you to join in with us. Glad to see some folks popping in on the page. Just say hello, amen. Shout out, because we want to acknowledge you for being with us here on tonight. Amen, amen. Join us if you would, real quickly. Tonight's going to be a good lesson. It's the third installment in our lesson, coming from 1 Peter chapter 3, 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 through 12. We've been dealing with these five verses, if you would, for the last three sessions, three times. Amen. I got some folks chiming in. Sister Ernest saying hello, and Candace says hello as well. So good, Sister Candace is with us on tonight. Amen. Amen. So listen, we're just thankful unto the Lord for all those who are coming in and joining with us on tonight. Again, just give us a quick hello. Amen. Who you are, where you are. We want to see who's in the house. So grab your Bibles, turn to 1 Peter chapter number 3, and we want to begin. Our focus is going to be in verses 10 through 12. So go ahead and grab your Bibles so that we can delve into tonight's lesson. But before we begin our study, let us whisper real briefly a word of prayer. I'm going to pray for us that God would give us illumination from his word. And I'm asking that you would whisper a prayer. And just good evening, Sister Valencia and Sister Ross. Thank you so much. Listen, and you pray for me that I would just have insight, because I desperately need your prayers in all that I do as we seek to pray for one another. Amen. So let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much for your goodness, grace, your abundance of mercy. As we come unto this teaching moment, we ask and pray that your Holy Spirit would give us wisdom and insight. Heavenly Father, give us clarity of your word. And may we not just be a hearer of your word, but may we be a doer, God. May we not be, as James said, someone who looks into the mirror, sees their reflection, and when they leave, they forgot what they saw. So as we study your word and we even see ourselves, the good, bad, and the indifferent, Heavenly Father, may we just know that your word is there to help us, to guide us, to free us, correct us, and all those things, oh God. So we love you and we thank you for it even right now. Bless each and every home represented under the sound of our voice, God. May you bless and guide and direct us as we study your word on tonight. And we ask it all in Jesus' mighty name. And all God's people said, amen, amen, amen. Well, for the last couple of weeks, we were dealing with, couple of sessions, we began dealing with in 1 Peter chapter 3, and we talked about how God wants us, verse 8, how God wants us to live holy lives, and in particular, how he wants us to live among ourselves, among Christians, among the church as a whole, amen? He deals with this idea of, and our lesson topic was more than members, but we're family. And so how we should be dealing with one another as members of the household of faith, as members of the body of Christ. And it doesn't matter whether we are members of our local congregation there at Minnehulla or here at Minnehulla, or if we are a part of the greater body of Christ within the Goliad community, the Crossroads area, the state of Texas, the United States, and abroad. We are all members, and we are all part of the body of Christ. Amen. We're all part of the body of Christ. And so God's word taught us in verse number 8 of 1 Peter 3 how we should live and deal with one another as children of God. And then on last session, pardon me, we dealt with this idea of how do we deal with devilish people. That was verse number 9. How do we deal? So first of all, we don't respond with retaliation. When folks act in devilish and wicked and evil, first thing is that we do not retaliate. We do not stoop to their level. We gave an illustration of the two ways in which we can deal, high road, low road. The late Councilman Eric Mays out of Michigan, Detroit, Michigan, would say when they go low, he goes lower, which means he gonna get down into the gutter with them. Former First Lady of the United States, Michelle Obama, says when they go low, when they go low, she goes high and encourage her children to take the high road. And that's what God calls us to do, that we are to take the high road when dealing with devilish people. Never get into the muck with them. Someone once said before, if you wrestle with a pig in the mud, he's okay with the mud. He don't mind being muddy. So you getting muddy, you don't like it. So when we stoop down to that, we are not to retaliate, not to get to that level, but we are to bless them. We have to respond with blessing. And that was verse number 9. Now we're going to get to verse numbers 10 through 12, verses 10 through 12 of 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 10 through 12. And we're going to be looking at I've entitled this section, session of our study, Living Your Blessed Life. We've heard oftentimes people say, I'm living my best life. But is that what God called us to be? So we're going to delve into that. Amen. We're going to delve living our best life. Amen. So 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 10 through 12. Here we go. It says here, for the one who desires life and to love and see good days must keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. He must turn away from evil and do good. He must seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are toward the righteous, and his ears attend to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Amen. That's our verses for tonight. That's our scriptural focus for tonight. For the eyes of the Lord are against those, or the face of the Lord are against those who do evil, but he attends to the prayer of the believer. So this idea of living our best life as opposed to our blessed life. So here's the main idea. As you are accustomed to hearing me, here's the whole Bible study lesson. The main idea of this lesson, God calls us to live a blessed life in Jesus Christ. God calls us to live a blessed life in Jesus Christ. That's the main idea. If you want to walk away and says, what was this whole lesson about? That's what the whole lesson is about. Now we're gonna break it down for a little bit. Are we ready? Best life or blessed life? Which one should we live? You want to live your best life or you want to live a blessed life? Which one should we live? Best or blessed? And some would say, well, can my best life be a blessed life or can a blessed life be my best life? Well, let's talk about that a little bit. Let's look into God's word and see what God's word teaches. But before we go into the scripture, I have some things to break down for us, if you would, real quickly. So what does it mean to live your best life? What does it mean? Real quickly, if you can drop something in the comment section, in the chat section, when you hear someone say, or when you say, or if you've said it, I'm living my best life. Someone says, I'm living my best life. What does that mean? What does that mean? Real quickly. Give me a few words or a quick sentence. When somebody says, I'm living my best life, or when they say that, what do they mean? What do you think they mean? If you said it, what does that mean? Or if you're seeking to live your best life, what does that mean? What is your best life? I'm living my best life. What's that mean? I'm living my best life. What does it mean to live your best life? Let me get two or three takers on that. What do you say? Somebody says they do what they want to make them happy. they do what they want to make them happy, okay? Peace and contentment, okay? All that you can possibly do, okay? Got a couple more that want to chime in. What does it mean to live your best life? Someone says they do what they want to do to make them happy. Peace and contentment. All that you can possibly do. Yeah. They're doing what makes them happy. Okay, cool. That's good. I like that. Well, here's the reality. Most of what we were saying or what has been shared is some of the common view. It's the common view. Now, there's some themes in here that we see, okay? There's some themes that that's going to pop up when we look at that, okay? Here it is. Want to show us some... What do people say living your best life means? I want to just show a few things. So first of all, Oprah Winfrey is given credit for this phrase, live your best life. Back in 2005, the Oprah magazine published a book called Living Your Best Life. And then in 2010, Oprah hosted a whole event entitled Live Your Best Life. And here, the sentiment was that each would be happier if we walked the path, watch this, we carved out for ourselves. The message was to be the best version of yourself. The sentiment is, we would be happier if we walked the path we carved out for ourselves. And so the message was to be the best version of yourself. That was when Oprah came out with this over 20 years ago. When I say Oprah, but she coined the phrase and picked up that mantle, and we talked about living your best life. And it's been morphed and taken to different places. And listen, it didn't stay in the United States. It didn't, this idea of living your best life, it didn't stay in the United States. Listen, here is a Kenyan writer, Benny is a Kenyan writer and content creator from Kenya, says, when people say they're living their best life, they are saying they are enjoying their lives. They are fulfilling their goals. And they have realized their dreams. Everything is almost going well in their lives. They don't have much to complain about. They're earning good money and they have almost everything they have. They have almost everything that they have or want. The statement might include some or all of the above. So it's not just an American thing, it's a global thing. Do we see some reoccurring themes or things, action here? It is, we walk the path we carved out for ourselves, living the best version of yourself. They are saying they are fulfilling their goals and they have realized their dreams. Everything is going well in their lives. Okay, so I see someone already, y'all already ahead of the lesson. Lil Duval. Now, many of y'all don't know Lil Duval. And listen, I suggest that you don't go listen to Lil Duval's that particular single. It's scripted. Let me just say it's censored. I chose not to put his cover picture on it. But when he was asked, what was the inspiration for Smile, Living Your Best Life? That's a song on his record. He says, it came He says, it just came from me being who I am, living my best life as far as just being happy and trying to put that energy out there for everybody else. At this time, there's a lot of music that's drug inspired, depressing, and sad. So it's a good time for something like this. Now, some of the lyrics and some of the message in Lil Duval's song, Smile, Living Your Best Life, it says, listen, don't worry about folks. Don't let folks bother you. You do your thing. Even he says in some of the lyrics, says some of the words, says, listen, you doing good. You doing all right. Don't be tripping on what you don't have, and so forth and so on. Matter of fact, one line in the song says, you know, you eating them crab legs on food stamp. So what you complaining for? You living your best life. Smile. So the theme, and some of us have caught it already. The bottom line is, living your best life is all about you. The focus is self-awareness, self-peace, self-pleasure. It's self. And some people will say something to the effect of, well, I got to take care of me. I got to focus on me. And in some ways, that's true. But I contend that a lot of times and oftentimes, it's so much focus on self that we don't focus on anything outside of ourselves. It's about having what I want. It's about having a path, as Oprah says, it's about carving out a path for yourselves. That means we're in charge of it. Now, 20 years ago, it was about, you know, being the best you that you could be, being the best representation. Now, living your best life is accompanied by selfies and pictures of folks out there doing water sports in Miami, out there on the beach, or they're jet set from this place to another place. And again, taking vacations, going to exotic places, nothing wrong with that. I'm all for it. I think we all need to take vacation. I think we all need to take time off. Amen. God gave us a time that we should Sabbath to get some rest. Nothing wrong with having nice clothes. Nothing wrong with eating nice food. But whenever it gets about self, living our best life, living my best life, we got to make sure it's not in contradiction, or it is not in conflict, competition with what God wants us to live. And that is to live our blessed life. So what is a blessed life? What's a blessed life? 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 10, and the A clause, the very first phrase in verse number 10, the very first phrase in verse number 10 tells us what the blessed life is. Here it is. For the one who desires life to love and see good days. Now, Peter is quoting a psalm. He's quoting an Old Testament scripture. And so the idea of a blessed life is a place where one who desires life to love and see good days. And then he's going to give us the steps or the keys. And I'm going to give you the keys in a few minutes. But here is what a blessed life is. Are we ready? Amen. Here's what the blessed life is. What does God want for our lives, for us? Life, love, and good days are are about having a joyful life in this world. So, contradictory to what you might have thought or what people may think, that God doesn't want us to have fun, that God doesn't want us to enjoy things in this life. That's why some people don't want to be Christians. They don't want to commit themselves to the Lord, not wholeheartedly for sure, because they say God is a spoiler and he's a damper of fun. It's not fun. And let me say this. Sometimes folks are looking for, when they come to church, to have fun. They're looking for stuff to make them feel good. And I'm not saying that you can't enjoy yourself at the fellowship. I'm not suggesting that you should. As a matter of fact, you should have joy in the fellowship. We should be able to have fun together. But it's more than that. It's about having a joyful life in this world. It is not It is not absent of troubles, but troubles do not shatter us. A blessed life, life, love, and good days, doesn't mean we won't have troubles. Psalm 30 and 5 says, weeping endure for the night, joy comes in the morning. So man born of woman is a few days, and all days are filled with trouble. So we know that troubles come. Trials come. But when you live in your blessed life, you're okay when troubles come. Here's the problem. When folks trying to live their best life, when folks want to live their best life, when trouble comes and it disrupts their best life, it disrupts their good time, it disrupts their ability to have what they want, then it shatters them. It messes with their head. It messes with their heart. Why? Because it was about who? Self. And the best life, quote unquote, you don't imagine bad things happening to you. You don't want troubles to come into your life. When you live in your best life, no, you don't want the bad things to happen. But when we live our blessed life, when we are living God's blessed life for us, we know troubles come because that's a part of life. Amen. But the troubles do not shatter us. It does not take us out. That's the difference. There's an expression, even within Christianity, denomination, it's all about doing good, feeling good, having prosperity. All things are well. The problem is they can't handle, and that theology cannot handle bad times. It doesn't know what to do with rough moments. So they would say something like, you must not be living right, or you sinning. No, the Bible says it rains on the just and the unjust. Having bad days, whether you're a believer or non-believer, you're going to have a bad day. Watch this. Let me give you some more of this. A blessed life is more than existing. It is living. He says, for those who desire life, love, and good days. God wants us to enjoy the things in life because we're connected to Jesus, who is the way, the truth, and the life. Some of us at times find ourselves just existing. We're not living. A blessed life says, I'm not just existing. I'm not just here. but God wants us to live. Jesus says, I came that you might have life and that more abundantly. So this idea of heaven coming and giving us life, it's eternal life. That's the hereafter. And abundance while until we get to the hereafter. And so if you're just existing, if we're just existing, going through the motions, we're not really living. We're just existing. But and to exist means you participate, you enjoy the things that God created. You are involved in the things that God is involved in. We're not just existing, but we are living. Anybody would be willing to testify and say there's times when all you did was just existed. You find yourself from time to time says, I'm just existing. I'm not really living. I'm not living. I'm existing. Can I get a whoop whoop? Amen. But you want to live, not just exist. Some of us are so caught up and afraid to do things, to walk by faith. So we just exist. We don't live. We don't enjoy what God has allowed us to experience and to see. That's a blessed life, to be able to see some things and to do some things. And again, you ain't got to be extravagant with it. It's not extravagance. Living our blessed life. What does God want for us? All right. So, what does God want for us? Life, love, and good days. That's enjoying our time. This idea of love, it says to love. For those who desire to love. To love calls us to seek the good of others. Do not allow hatred to fester in our hearts. That can mess up your blessed life. Harboring hatred, or festering, let those things fester in your heart. My heart goes out to those who allow that to capture and to smother their lives. It takes a lot of energy to stay mad. It takes away our relationship with the Lord. It dampens it. It's an intentional avoidance of things that oppose God and his will to love. It is literally to hate, be repulsed by the things that God hates. And then to firmly hold to and do those things that pleases God. The blessed life says, I want to love. So I'm gonna let go some stuff that's holding me back. And I'm gonna cling to that and hold firm to that which pleases God. That's the blessed life. That makes sense so far? We okay so far? Can I get an amen if we okay so far? All right. Let's go a little deeper now. Let's go a little further. Okay. So what does it take to live our blessed life? Verse 10, the first statement says, for those who desire to live, love, and good days and see good days. Then it gives the keys to what it takes. It gives the keys. It says, watch this, must keep their tongue from evil and their lips from speaking deceit. He or she must turn away from evil and do good. He must seek peace and pursue it, for the eyes of the Lord are toward the righteous, and his ears attend to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Again, Peter is pointing back to the Psalms. He says, those who desire a good life and to live and see good day, to love and to see good days, it's an imperative. It's a requirement. If you and I want a blessed life, here are, and I'm going to give us four things, four keys to living your blessed life. You ready? Four keys. Here we go. Four things to living your best life, your blessed life. Refrain from evil speech and actions. Check out God's word. Can we see it? Psalm 1, verse 1 and 2 from the English Standard Version says, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sit in the seat of scoffers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. Listen, if you would, once again, or to Psalm 15, verses 1, 2, and 3. O Lord, who may abide in your tent? Who may dwell on your holy hill? What the psalmist is asking is, God, who can be in your presence? Who can come and convene in your space? He says, here's the answer. He who walks with integrity and works righteousness and speaks truth in his heart. That means what you say is what you mean. And you're not lying and you're not conniving. He does not slander with his tongue, nor does evil to his neighbor, nor takes up a reproach. Okay? Those are the things that against his friends, we are called to refrain from evil speech and actions. If we're going to live a blessed life, the Bible teaches us that we ought to refrain from evil speech and actions. Blessed is the man that does not walk in the counsel of the ungodly. In other words, I'm not trying to listen to the ungodly's counsel. I'm not trying to do the things that sinners do. I'm not going to sit and act judgmental, sit in the seat of scoffers. Here's what a scoffer does. A scoffer watches someone pass. He said they would sit. Here's the image. There will be people who would sit at the gates as they were coming through the city in Jerusalem, or because most of the cities were gated cities, okay? And they would sit, and all they would do was just talk about and criticize and critique people as they pass by. Man, time out for all that. All we can see is the negative and the bad in people, and never the good. Let me help us real quick. Sometimes we don't want to release people out of our own heart, even though God has released them from his penalty. Okay, what you trying to say, Pastor? We don't, because some people have not been punished the way we think they should have been punished. We still want to critique them for what God has forgiven them of. Write that down again. We critique people and judge people based upon the things that God has forgiven them of. That's a scoffer. So watch this. What if God kept bringing back my mess and your mess and throwing it in your face? None of us would be pleased with that. We ought to refrain from that. If we're going to live the blessed life, because, and I'll show you this in the last one, God's going to judge us on those things. I want to be able to come into God's presence. I want to be able to come into the space and place of God, not just at the sanctuary, but every place in my prayer life. Who may abide in your tent? In other words, who can come into your presence? Who can dwell on your holy hill? He who walks with integrity. Integrity simply means you're sound. If a desk is sound, if it's sturdy, it has integrity. Who works righteousness. They work at doing right. We'll see that in a minute. Speaks truth on their heart. Here again is the speech time, or what we do with our mouths. James said, the tongue is the smallest member of the body, yet it causes the most damage. Our tongue, if you put it on a scale and weighed it out, would weigh less than a pound. But it's the heaviest and the most destructive organ in our bodies, our mouths. We got to learn how to shut up. Stop talking. Stop slandering with our tongue. Taking up a reproach here against his friend. You upset with your friend. Evil speech and action. We are to reason to always do right. Second key, reason to always do right. Psalm 17 verses 4 and 5. This from the New Living Translation. I have found your commands. I have followed your commands, which keep me from following cruel and evil people. My steps have stayed on your path. I have not wavered from following you. I have followed your commands, which keep me from following cruel and evil people. If you want to do right, and you want to do what God wants, find out what his commands are. And once you find what his commands are, you'll know whether or not you should be hooking up with certain people or not. Because everyone that you quote unquote friend is not really your friend. I'm going to preach on this probably in the next few weeks or so. At least I think that's a part of my preaching schedule. It's about who we hooking up with. Don't be unequally yoked is the passage that we're going to deal with. Find out who you're hooking up with, who you're tied to. We go back to what the psalmist says. Here it is. Does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, stand in the way of sin, nor sit in the seat of the scornful. Doesn't do that. He works righteousness. Here we go again. I have followed your commands, which keep me from following cruel and evil people. And just because I keep God's commands and I follow his commands doesn't mean cruel and evil people won't try to lure me, nor does it mean they're going to stop operating around me. But what it does do is, because I'm hooked up with his word and I'm attached to his commands, what I am going to do is I want to follow his commands and make sure that I'm in right standing with him. Watch this. He says, my steps have stayed on your path. Well, that's different than someone else's saying, carve or create your own path. I want to know the path that God has for me. Proverbs 1 says, in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he will do what? Direct thy path. I want to acknowledge you, Lord. And I want to do what's right. Now, does that mean, brothers and sisters, we always do what's right at all times? No. But I reason to always do right. I like the way Paul said it in Romans. When I want to do good, I realize evil is at every hand. The things that I don't want to do, I do. Things that I do want to do, I don't do. But I'm thankful to God that he's there to help me to get straight and to get corrected. I reason to always do right. That's the second key. That's the second key. Watch this. Do everything possible. I skipped ahead of one. Here we go. Pursue peace and harmony. That's the third step. That's the third key. Listen, Romans 12, verse 8 through 21. Read it from the Good News Bible says, do everything possible on your part to live in peace with everybody. Never take revenge, my friends, but instead let God's anger do it. For the scripture says, I will take revenge, I will pay back, says the Lord. Instead, as the scripture says, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they're thirsty, give them a drink. For by doing this, you will make them burn with shame. Now, you can go back to the last session, the last week's lesson, and you can get the whole lesson on this one. But watch verse 21. Do not let evil defeat you. Instead, conquer evil with good. Listen at this verse one more time. Do everything possible on your part to live in peace with everyone. So I'm going to say this, and so that we can just get this out of our system. You and I are not responsible for how people respond. Let me say it one more time. You and I are not responsible for how other people respond. We're only responsible for how we respond and what we do. So this next statement would be probably both comforting and hard to hear. But let me say it this way. When you and I, as much as it's possible on our end to live in peace with everyone, doesn't mean everyone wants to live in peace with you. The scripture says, do everything possible on your part to live in peace with everyone. So here's my responsibility. Do everything I can to live at peace with everybody. Does not mean everyone wants to live at peace. Some people want to stay in chaos. Some folks want to stay in a disruptive situation. They don't want to be healed. They don't want to be freed. That's not my response. That's not my problem. That's their problem. My heart breaks for them because they would prefer to stay in bondage. Bondage of hatred, bondage of unforgiveness, bondage of all this. That's on them. But as far as it is, on me, I'm pursuing peace and harmony. Never taking revenge. Let God handle that. I like the last verse 21 says, do not let evil defeat you. Instead, conquer evil with good. Martin Luther King Jr. said this years ago, over 60 years ago. He says, evil does not defeat evil. Only good. Again, listen, as much as it is possible on your part, live at peace. That is the absence of strife. That's the absence of chaos. You don't be the problem. You don't be the cause of chaos. Do everything possible on your part to live at peace with everyone. How are we doing so far? Are we good? Here is the fourth key. Remember, God rewards according to our ways. Remember that God will reward us according to our ways. Galatians 6, verses 7 through 10. Good News Bible. Do not deceive yourselves. No one makes a fool of God. People will reap exactly what they sow. That's what breaks your heart as well. Because you know the things that you're sowing, the things that we sow, we're going to have to reap. My brothers and sisters, there's times I ask God, please allow there to be crop failure. God, because I know the things that I may have sown will come back bad. But things that were good will come back. Watch this. He says, if you sow in the field, if they sow in the field of their natural desires, from it, they will gather the harvest of death. If they sow in the field of the Spirit, from the Spirit, they will gather the harvest of eternal life. So let us not become tired of doing good. For if we do not give up, the time will come when we will reap the harvest. So then, as often as we have the chance, we should do good to who, y'all? Who? The people that I like? My family members? Folk that look like me? Folks that's my color? Folks that are going to give me something back good? No. We should do good to everyone, especially to those who belong to our family in the faith. God will reward us according to our ways. Here's the thing I love about God. He's gracious. He's patient. He's long-suffering. And I bet you some of you can say the same thing, that you're grateful to God that he's patient and long-suffering. And he allows us to correct ourselves and allow his Spirit to correct us before he punishes, before he disciplines, before he does whatever. But we have to understand that God will reward us according to our ways. Sometimes the reward, the way we get, we may not like it. But the Bible says in verse 12 that God attends, his ear is attentive to the ears of those who follow him. God rewards always. If we're going to have a blessed life, if we're going to live the blessed life, if that's what our desire is, to live a blessed life, we must take these four keys into consideration. Application for life. Which are you pursuing, your best life or a blessed life? You deal with that. You grapple with that. Which are you pursuing, your best life or a best life, blessed life? What do you need to do what do you need to do to ensure you are living and not just existing? What do you need to start doing to ensure that you are living and not just existing? Then for something for you to ponder, which of the four keys do you need to work on the most? Which of the four keys do you need to work on the most? Questions, comments, thoughts? Questions, comments, thoughts. maybe gotta let some stuff sink in, I guess. I'm with you. Living your blessed life. Living your blessed life. All right. I'm always going to remind us, we've got Sunday school every Sunday. Sunday school is the place to be. Adults and students, children. So come out. Please be a part of the Sunday school experience. Somebody said, I know they needed this. Thank you, Sister Kruger, for saying that. Always want to make sure people understand and have a way that they can give and support the work of the ministry. You can give in person when you come to service on Sunday, or you can use one of our electronic means, Givelify or Cash App. Or if you choose to, you can mail it in. Either way, you have the means, and there are options in which how we can support the work of the ministry. Amen. All right, time for us to pray. Time for us to pray. If you desire prayer for yourself, say, pray for me. Type in, pray for me. If you want to put the request in the chat section, please do so. Please feel free to do so. But if you just want to drop in, pray for me, and trust that God knows what your needs are. When we say pray for you, are we going to pray for you and just ask that God hear your prayer? If you want us to intercede and stand in the gap with you as you are praying for someone else or something outside of yourself, just drop in the chat, pray with me. Pray with me. Perhaps there's some things that God has blessed you with, and God has blessed all of us, and you just want us to praise and celebrate with you. Just drop in, praise with me. Pray for me. Pray with me, praise with me. Amen. Sister Flo is asking that we pray with and for her. Sister Ernestine is asking that we pray with and for her. Sister Ferris is asking that we pray with and for her. We want to continue to keep our brothers and sisters on our prayer list. Sister Candace, as she's recovering, thank God she was online. Thank God that she's recovering, and God is going to continue to do a mighty work in her life. We want to pray for Sister Pat Collins as she goes through and continues her healing that God is working in our life. Brother Alfredo Camacho, great brother, man. He's just inspiration. He's going through some challenging time, but he's just having faith in the Lord. Let's pray, continue to pray for Brother Lane and his healing, and also Brother Ryan Edwards. Amen. Sister Brittany Brown is asking that we pray for the Garza family in Beeville. They had a co-worker who lost her husband. So the Garza family in their time of bereavement. Thank you, Sister Brittany. We're going to definitely be lifting the Garza family up. This is Antoine asked that we pray for Brother Raina. All right, let's pray together. If you have some more you want to drop them in, we'll see them as they come through, and we'll lift them up in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your goodness, grace, and your abundance of mercy. How we give you praise and thanks, oh God, for we know that you are a prayer-hearing God, that you respond to our requests, and you know everything that we have need of. So God, as we come before you, we come, first of all, with thanksgiving and praise. We come knowing that you are a God who hears our every request, our every answer, or our every need. So God, we even ask now, and join our faith together as we lift up Sister Flo and we pray for her. And God, may you bless, may you hear, and may you be attentive to her requests, oh God. We pray with her as she's praying outside of herself. Even as she's going through what she's going through, she's seeking you, oh God, to bless her and to give her what she needs. So we ask even now that you would hear our prayer. God, we lift our Sister Ernestine and we pray and we join our faith together and we lift her up before you, God, and we pray that your blessings would flow in her life, that you would hear her prayer, that you would respond in the affirmative, oh God, and respond to her needs, oh God. Meet her every need. And then we pray with her, oh God, as she prays for others around her. We entrust and trust that you will hear our prayer, Lord. So hear our prayer. God, we pray and lift up Sister Ferris and ask your strength, blessing, healing, comfort, all those things in her life. Oh God, minister right now. God, hear her prayer that she's offered unto you. And then we pray with her, oh God, and we join our faith with her as she prays outside of herself. God, just touch, minister, and move in a mighty way. God, we lift up those, oh God, don't know all their names, but we pray that you would be with them, that you would help them, and we pray for and with them. And God, please just hear our prayer. God, we lift up the Garza family in their times of bereavement, their time of, may you, Lord God, be their healer. May you be their comforter. May you give them peace that surpasses understanding. God, be their strength and comfort. God, may their friends and loved ones bring them joy and peace in the midst of all that they're going through. God, we lift up Brother Renee and pray your blessings upon him. We pray your guidance and direction in his life. We pray that he seeks out doctors and medical care that is that can meet his needs, that can do the work that needs to get done and do it well. We pray that you would just bless even right now. God, we thank you for Sister Candace's continual improvement, and we pray that you would continue to watch over her and keep her, God. Be with Sister Pat Collins and give her strength in her body and her being, that she could walk with strength and energy, God, and vigor and vitality. God, we lift up Brother Alfredo. God, we thank you for his faith and how he trusts in you and how he surrenders all to you and he commits himself unto you and to your healing touch. God, be with Brother Lane and bring healing and restoration, oh God. May his recovery go well, oh God, in you. God, we're faithful. We know that you're faithful. So we faithfully and we in faith, we just lift him up before you, God. God, be with Brother Ryan and then bring healing and wholeness to his body and his being. Help him, oh God, in all the things that he has need of. God, how we love you and thank you. God, help us to not just be hearers of your word, but to be a doer. Help us to fulfill that which you've called and commanded us to do. God, how we love you and we thank you for it even right now. Watch over us and keep us, oh God, as we go our various ways for the rest of this night, that we might rise in the morning at or another day to serve you and to fulfill your will for our lives. God, we thank you and we praise you for it even now and ask it all in Jesus' mighty name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Blessings to everyone. We pray that you have a great night, evening, day, whenever time that you are sharing and engaged in this time of study. So God's blessings to all of you. We will see you on Sunday. God's blessings. Peace.